Greetings, all you 99 percenters. This is your host, Dr. Jack Rasmus. This is Alternative Visions. Okay, the big news of the week, of course, is the signing of the China-U.S. trade deal, the mini deal, the phase one, as they call it, or as it's being called, as if there's going to be a phase two, which will be essentially happy talk and not much else. I want to talk about that in some depth here today and give you an explanation of what are the terms and conditions, the major terms and conditions underlying that deal, and why, as I've written just today on my blog, jackrasmus.com, why the deal is just a feeble trade deal. Not much there. All right, so we're going to talk about that today. And in the second half of the show, I want to continue this trend we have on the show of trying to make sense of the past year and the past decade, in fact. We've talked about the 10 most important economic events in the U.S. here in 2019, and then the 10 most important political events in 2019 last week. So listen to our show podcast here for the 10 most important political events and the 10 most important economic events in the show before that. Okay, last 2 weeks here. And I want to talk about then the 10 most important developments in technology here in the second half of the show. Why technology? Because it's really critical to what's going on economically and politically. So we need to keep our eye on technology. It's the most important single development going on that's really has a lot to do with what's going on economically and even politically now, undermining that political system and what democracy we do have, or contributing to it, at least. So we're going to talk about the 10 most important technology developments of the past year in the second half of the show. But let's move on and talk about the 10 most important, mini trade deal. Actually, you know, there were two important trade events in the past week. One was the U.S. Senate ratifying the NAFTA 2.0, the USMCA, as they call it. So we had two important trade developments that occurred. We'll talk about the USMCA next week or another show. It still is not signed by Canada, so it's not really a deal that's going into effect yet. It should. Pretty much unchanged as far as Canada is concerned, NAFTA 2.0. So we'll talk about that another show. I want to talk about the China trade deal because the trade wars are over. You know, nothing else is going to be achieved here in election year. That includes with China. Yeah, there'll be things called trade phase two discussions. But it won't amount to anything. It'll just be discussions, and I'll explain why here. And, of course, you're not going to see any significant developments in trade elsewhere, trade wars, in an election year. Why? Because no country is going to agree to any significant change this close to the U.S. election, 2020 elections next November. So there won't be anything more. Trade wars are over. Well, you know, you can expect Trump to maybe go after Europe more aggressively. By the way, our deficit with Europe is worse than it has been with China. But there's political and social difficulties going after Europe the way he went after China. But he will turn his attention now. You know, there are some minimal tariffs have been imposed on European wine, and distilled goods, and some farm goods. Only a couple billion in terms of tariffs. But Trump will now turn towards Europe more aggressively. But it'll be mostly talk. So the trade wars are over under Trump, at least during his first term here. And of course, the biggest, most important trade development was the trade war against China, which, as I've always said, was really also a cover for an emerging tech war between the U.S. and China. We'll talk about that. Well, we have in past shows, but we'll reiterate. What do we mean by the trade war is over, the tech war has just begun? Okay, that's a theme. Well, what do we see in this China-U.S. Phase one, as it's called, which is phase last, a mini trade deal here? Well, not surprisingly, a lot of hype, a lot of gross exaggeration by Trump and his cabinet, exaggeration and hyperbole and so forth. And let's take that apart and see what's really going on. You know, a way to preview our comments here is perhaps to quote to you a quote on January 13th, earlier this week here, by a guy named Ben Steele, Director of International Economics for the Council on Foreign Relations, CFR. Well, now, what's the CFR? Why is it important? Because it is the capitalists, one of the capitalists' main think tanks. Been around a long time, the CFR. This is, membership in the CFR is left to the real elite, the traditional elite, the big capitalists. And they have a bevy of researchers, commentators. They have their own journal called CFR, or Foreign Relations Journal, I think it's called. Anyway, it represents the thinking of a wing of the U.S. capitalist class, the big wing, anyway. And so what does this guy Ben Steele, Director of International Economics for the CFR, say that summarizes this phase one deal? And why is it important that he says it just before the signing? Well, this is what he said. Quote, China is set to do little more than restore agricultural purchases and offer some nice words on financial services and intellectual property. Trump could have had that 2 years ago without the tariff damage. Well, that's quite an indictment, isn't it? Pretty much saying, Donald, you didn't get anything you could have had 2 years ago without tariffs. And there isn't that much there. You restore agricultural purchases and some nice words on financial services, in other words, intellectual property and technology transfer. Okay, so, the CFR does not think there's much there. You know, as I said, a famous writer said, there's no there. Yeah. Well, what's really in phase one then? Right? And as I point out in my article, Trump's feeble phase one China-U.S. trade deal, which you can read in more detail on my blog, jackrasmus.com, what's really, really in it, right? And what are the negative impacts on the economy, on households, on businesses, farmers, and the global economy? Well, let's investigate that. First of all, what first term, terms and conditions, in other words, what is it that Trump is really boasting about that he achieved, which he really didn't achieve for various reasons, we'll see. Well, one thing, well, some things he did achieve. Well, one thing is this. Okay. They negotiated 51% majority ownership for U.S. businesses, especially banks, in China. Up until now, companies doing business in China had to do it with joint ventures. But now they can have 51% ownership. Well, Trump is bragging that that's in the agreement, right? Well, that's really a lie, because China began implementing the 51% ownership rule back in 2018. Several European banks, and including Goldman Sachs and from the U.S. Investment Bank, have already begun setting up full ownership operations over there. So this is something that has been already granted by China not something that Trump has negotiated, right? He didn't get anything there that China already offered and gave to others. Yeah. But he claims it, of course. Okay. Another term condition in the agreement that Trump is bragging about having achieved is an agreement by China to end its manipulation of its currency. Yeah, they even had a big PR announcement of that a couple days ago, right? The U.S. had been indicting China for manipulating its currency, and now it says it's not a currency manipulator because we got an agreement it wouldn't be any longer. Okay. Well, what do we mean by currency manipulation? And has China been, in fact, a currency manipulator? Currency manipulation means that the government takes action to buy and sell it and other currencies in the global money markets in order to devalue its currency, to force its devaluation. Devaluation means its currency is worth less and the dollar is worth more. Well, if your currency is worth less, your costs of doing business, i.e. exports, right, are less. You become more competitive. You lower the value of your currency, and that makes your goods and services more competitive, and you take some market share, you know, in certain industries away from your competitors. Yeah. So the U.S. has been saying that China has been manipulating its currency, meaning lowering the value of its currency, up to now, but Trump negotiated an agreement that they would stop this. Well, that's a lie. You know, that's another, that's a bald-faced lie. Because if anything, China has been buying and selling currencies in an open market in order to stabilize its currency, prevent it from devaluing. You know, it trades the yuan, China's currency, trades in a certain band, you know, between, I think it's six and 7.1 yuan to the dollar, to the U.S. dollar. And it's been stable there, you know, at least from around 2015-16, because China has been preventing its currency from devaluing, even as the U.S. dollar has been rising in value, which puts pressure on China's currency and all other currencies to devalue. The rising dollar, for example, has caused havoc in Latin American currencies, which have been really falling in value. Some other local reasons are driving that as well. It's not just the U.S. dollar is rising. But, you know, the dollar is the global currency, and as it rises, this is the way currency exchange rates work, other currencies fall. And when your currency falls, you know, especially if too much, then investors in your country want to get the hell out of investing in your country because they're losing profits just by the currency declining. So they take their money and they go to the U.S., move it to the U.S., right, where the dollar is rising. They buy dollars so they can make a profit on the rising dollar rather than lose profits on their own falling currency. So you get what's called capital flight. Flows out of the country. And, of course, new capital won't flow in. You know, why should an investor invest in that country? Because it has to convert its dollars or other currency into the currency of the local country to do business in that country. Well, why should it do that when once it buys the currency of the local country, the currency collapses further, declines, devalues further? Why should it do that? Well, that, in other words, it stifles foreign investment into your country, just as it causes your investors to flee, capital flight they call it, from your country, usually into the dollar, which is rising. Okay, so the U.S. dollar rising has been the big reason why currencies have been declining, and that's true as well in the case of China. which means it's been putting pressure, the rising dollar has been putting pressure on the yuan to devalue. But China's been intervening, buying and selling its currency in order to keep its currency in the stable range. Yeah. So if anything, its behavior has been opposite of currency manipulator. Because manipulation means that you're trying to devalue your currency, not keep it stable. And you see the U.S. is really terrified that China's currency will devalue. Because that means if it devalues, the tariffs that have been levied on China are offset, eliminated. It's very easy to eliminate rising tariffs by simply letting your currency devalue. You know, and Trump had put, close to 500 threat or actually implemented 500 billion of tariffs on China. He's still keeping 370 billion. We'll talk about that. Well, China could easily have devalued its currency or just let market forces, rising dollar market forces devalue it. It didn't even have to go in and do it itself. And that appeared as possible last August when, Trump added all the hundreds of billions of additional tariffs and it looked like the tariff war was going to become a real economic war. The U.S. Stock markets took a deep dive and everything got pretty shaky there in August, right? Well, it got shaky in part because China's response was, okay, you're adding more tariffs to us. We're just going to let market forces devalue our currency. And the yuan traded right up there at the edge, 7.1 to the dollar. Yeah, 7.1 to the dollar. And that was a signal by China. Hey, you want to levy more tariffs? We'll just let the yuan devalue. But they didn't, you see. Trump backed off, and China then continued to enter into the market to stabilize its currency. Why does China do this? Because China wants the yuan to become a global trading currency. And if other countries are going to start using the yuan has to remain stable. No one, as I said, wants to use a currency that's fluctuating, particularly devaluing. Right. So China has a long-term perspective here, and China is going to do as it has been, whatever it needs to maintain its currency stable. And if you should see the yuan devalue, then it's really a signal that there's deep problems going on and the economic war has begun. Not the tariff war that we've seen, but a broader, deeper economic war. So, basically this discharge by Trump that he achieved in the phase one deal limits restrictions on currency manipulation, and China's no longer manipulating its currency, therefore they could declare it's not a currency manipulator. Is all false. It's a lie, they've been saying this for years that China's a currency manipulator, and so had Obama, but that was just for public consumption, to make China look like, it's the bogeyman here, and it's the cause of our trade problems, and, it's because it's manipulating its currency. Okay, so that was the second false claim. The 51%, which was already granted, and the currency manipulation, which was a bald-faced lie. Okay, so the next element in the Phase One agreement that Trump has claimed is intellectual property and technology transfer. Intellectual property, what is that? Well, movie piracy. Music piracy, creative entertainment, but it's also software development, it's other creative economic work, especially when they, when the U.S. says intellectual property, it heavily means pharmaceutical, you know, drugs, new drugs, big pharma. You know, the U.S. is on everywhere trying to protect big pharma and their ripoff profits, right? And IP protections relate to big pharma. Yeah. Well, it just came out today inside here, you know, that they discovered a, the drug companies have discovered a pharmaceutical solution to hemophilia, right? And they're just coming out with a hemophilia drug here. Oh, but it's going to cost you $1 million to get treated for your hemophilia. $1 million. Yeah. That's even worse than the treatment for hepatitis C here, which is about $80,000. Yeah, if you got hepatitis, you can get it eliminated with taking one pill here, I think, every week or maybe every month, you know, and after 2-3 months, it's gone. Yeah. We'll talk about these solutions, prescription solutions here in the second half of the show, because that's part of the new technology. Anyway, IP means for the U.S., let's protect the big drug companies. And we saw that, by the way, also in the USMCA, the NAFTA 2.0. Yeah. In other words, what the U.S. wants is no replication of these drugs by other countries. In other words, you've got to buy and pay for $1 million if you want hemophilia cured, right? And in the USMCA agreement, there's a provision that says 10 years, U.S. pharmaceuticals are protected for 10 years from a copycat and more affordable copycat and drug creations by other countries. Well, it was 12 years, you see, and they got this big, the Democrats got this big change. Instead of 12 years protection, 10 years protection. Okay, we'll talk about that when we talk about NAFTA 2.0. But intellectual property means, you know, largely that and software. And the U.S. is claiming, well, we've got new limits, a new deal on protecting IP, right? And new limits on tech transfer. Mm-hmm. Well, if you remember the quote by Ben Steele of the Council of Foreign Relations, you know, what did he say? Well, you know, he said, not much there, right? Some nice words on intellectual property. Nice words. Now, the provisions there are very weak on IP and tech transfer. What's tech transfer? Well, that's where in China, if a company was doing a joint venture, which is what it had been limited to, no longer, right? It couldn't force that company to share the technology with China. Okay. Well, wait a minute. If you got a joint venture, in other words, two companies own a company, right? How can you separate out both sides or both parties to the joint venture using the technology? It's almost impossible, right? But that's what the U.S. means by tech transfer. Somehow they want they wanted U.S. companies in China not being able to, you know, have a single venture. In a joint venture, they had to share the technology. Well, that's the nature of a joint venture. Well, anyway, that's gone because now, you know, it's 51% or more ownership, right? So the question is, will they have to share technology with China, with the government? Well, the deal is that they don't have to turn the technology over to China's government anymore. You know, there's all kind of ways of getting to the technology, right? Other than just turning it over, declaring to China government that here's this new technology we have, right? China will find other ways for the tech information to get to its other companies, it's a government, wholly owned government subsidiaries or whatever, right? That's not going to stop the tech transfer, right? But Trump will and is claiming, oh, this is a big deal, you know, we got this big change. Mm-hmm. According to Derek Scissors of the American Enterprise Institute, another think tank, right? In the phase one deal, the Chinese have, quote, I'm quoting Scissors now, have committed to continue doing the same thing they've always been doing. Mm. In other words, they'll find a way. And there's nothing really in this agreement that except happy words on IP and tech transfer. All right. And by the way, both parties have agreed not to have any terms and conditions in the phase one deal about cyber theft. Right? The U.S. had demanded that China do something to prevent cyber theft. But look, companies all over the world are stealing from each other, spying on and stealing from each other here through cyber means, right? And of course, China would not agree to that because the U.S. wanted a one-way deal. Right? The U.S. refused to agree on cyber theft of China. So, you know, why would the Chinese agree to it with the U.S.? All these companies and countries are all spying on each other all the time. You know, Israel spies on the U.S. all the time. It gets high-level military secrets. You know, it comes out once in a while. You know, but of course, the U.S. does nothing to them. IP and tech transfer, yeah, not much there. All right, here's the big issue that's really been hyped, and that's farm goods purchases and purchases of U.S. goods by China. Now, what you read in the press is that Trump is claiming that China's agreed to buy $200 billion more in goods over the next 2 years, because this phase one thing is only 2 years, you see. $200 billion more, $100 billion roughly, a year. That $100 billion a year divided roughly between $50 billion farm goods purchases and $50 billion of non-farm goods, mostly energy goods, meaning natural gas, oil, natural gas, into $50 billion non-farm goods, but also some manufacturing, etc. Let's look at this. Huh? $50 billion in farm goods. Well, now, they're saying $40 billion. Right? But most economists don't think that China will buy anything near $50 billion or $40 billion in addition to the purchases that's already been made. So, in other words, now, of course, it's $40 billion. They backed off of that. Okay, so $40 billion. How much of that is actually net new farm purchases? Well, only $16 billion, because in 2017, before the war began, trade war, tariff war began, they were buying about $24 billion from the U.S. So $16 billion more, right? They'll go back to restore the 24 and buy $16 billion more. So that's $40 billion. But economists are wondering whether they can even do that so quickly in 1 year, because during the tariff wars here, China went and signed contracts with other countries in the world, like for soybeans and other grains, Brazil and others. And China has said, in the signing of this phase one, that it's not going to change those other agreements. No, it's not going to stop buying from Brazil and buy from the U.S. Right? That's not going to happen. So we only got $16 billion here. You know, it's not $40 billion. It's $16 billion. And there's some question whether that can be actually fulfilled. And by the way, the $16 billion is really making up for the decline in the foreign purchases by China in the last 2 years during the tariff war. It fell to $7 billion a year at one point, annual, right? So by buying $16 billion in each of the next 2 years, 2020, 2021, right, $32 billion more, they're really making up for the shortfall that occurred in the last 2 years. You see, far less than the $24 billion, which was 2017, last year before the war, to trade war, right? So, you know, really it's a restoration of levels and a restoration of lower purchases that occurred in the last 2 years. There's nothing really net new here, big deal increase, right? It's a restoration over the last 2 years, right? And by the way, it expires in just 2 years. Well, you know, when you plant farm goods, you need to look far into the future because, you know, if you got a big increase in production output, you're going to have to bring new land into production. And that costs a lot of money to prepare it and get it ready for expanded production. And you can't do that if it's just 2 years. Farmers can't do that, right? So the fact that it's such a short-term agreement also mitigates against the fact that we're going to see this big expansion of farm sales, right? It's a return to the status quo ante of 2017, that's all, right? Okay, so you know, that's the real picture on farm good purchases, right? What about the increase in oil energy purchases? You know, that's about natural gas. China needs natural gas because it's trying to get away from dirtier coal, right? You know, we'll. That probably won't happen either for reasons we'll talk about. But, you know, overlaying all of this stuff about, you know, what's been achieved on farm purchases is what China has said about the Phase One agreement and quotas or what it will actually purchase. Well, as its chief negotiator, Liu He, has said here, China will make farm purchases and all purchases, quote, according to the needs of Chinese consumers and as market conditions determine. In other words, there's no guarantee it's even going to buy $40 billion a year. There's no guarantee there, you know. It depends. Well, if we need to, we will. It's a target number. It's not a legally guaranteed number. Okay, but Trump would make you believe that it's $40, $50 billion in farm purchases. All right. Another major element is that the tariffs will remain. U.S. tariffs, $370 billion of tariffs will remain on Chinese goods. Right? He's declared he won't reduce the tariffs. Well, as I've said, you know, that's the condition number one for China for buying more. And China's position clearly is, well, you reduce the tariffs more, we'll probably buy more. But, you know, we're not going to buy more. We'll do it according to market conditions if you keep those tariffs. Well, Trump says he's got to keep the tariffs to enforce the current agreement with China, right? So it's kind of like a weapon that he clears will a tool, right? Well, China's got a quid pro quo tool, and that is simply to slow or delay purchases of the $40 billion, right? We'll see which takes precedence here. Trump's tariffs are China's definition of demand in market conditions. There's going to be a lot of tension over this going forward here. This is not a clear deal, you might say. All right, so why is Trump keeping all these tariffs? Well, he says it's for a tool, but I think this is part of the deal he had to make with the neocons and the factions on the U.S. trade team, represented by the Pentagon, the military-industrial complex, you know, Navarro and Lighthizer. These were the neocons who were using the tariffs as a way of trying to shake out China on its technology, its next-gen technology, to slow down or share that next-gen technology with the U.S. I've talked about that on the show before. You know, our next-gen means artificial intelligence, cybersecurity, and 5G wireless. These are the technologies of the industries of the future next decade. Well, we're in that decade. But they're also the military technologies. You know, artificial intelligence and 5G together are critical for military development in the next future, right? Drones, the use of drones and targeting, right? Hypersonic missiles and hypersonic torpedoes coming require, you know, artificial intelligence. They'll do their own targeting on their own. And 5G wireless in order to monitor that. A battlefield coordination and communication, you know, between different humans on the battlefield and their machines on the battlefield. All that's artificial intelligence, 5G. And the U.S. wanted China to back off on that. And the neocons were using the tariffs to pressure China. It didn't succeed. The whole tech issue has been decoupled from the tariff issue. But that does not mean that the tech war is over. No, trade tariff war with China is over, but the tech war has only begun, and it's going to intensify here on a separate track. Right? So, you know, my guess was that Trump kept these tariffs to get the neocon faction on his trade team to agree to a phase one, a mini deal, by saying, oh, look, we'll keep these tariffs, and we'll use these tariffs in phase two to go after tech. You know, let's take what we can, minimally what we can. You know, I got an election coming up. I got to show something. And we'll come back at them in phase two here, and we'll hold our tariffs as in our back pocket as our pressure tool here on China. Well, it's not going to work. As I said, phase two is going to be a farce, first of all. Just talk. Nothing's going to come of it in election year. If Trump wants more farm goods and other purchases, he's going to have to lower those tariffs. We'll see whether he does that or not to keep the discussions going. If he doesn't change from $370 billion, nothing's going to happen. Okay. All right. So the tariffs will remain, and that's the connection between tariffs and the tech war between the U.S. and China. All right, so another area of provisions in the deal. You know, what are the other areas here? Manufacturing and services. In addition to the $32 billion more in farm purchases, right, phase one calls for $78 billion over 2 years here, right, in manufacturing and services purchases over the next 2 years, right? But most of the manufacturing purchases was for Boeing aircraft, right, which is now plagued with shipment cancellations worldwide due to the 737 MAX, right? And the $38 billion in services purchases involved mostly China purchases of U.S. education services and China tourism to the U.S., both of which are now being cut back sharply by Trump. U.S. policy is now to discourage Chinese students and research academics coming to the U.S. In fact, Trump is trying to drive them out. Right? Trump's argument is these folks are the source of some technology transfer. And, of course, China tourism to the U.S. Will slow as relations between the two countries continue to deteriorate in general. So, I don't really foresee that number, a target number, again, not a guaranteed legal number of, $38 billion in purchases of services by China and $78 billion purchases of manufacturing goods, given Boeing situation. China will turn to Airbus now, and are developing its own fleet. That's certainly a commercial aircraft fleet. That's well down the road, that one. U.S. auto exports to China will not be affected much either. There's a major slump in China auto sales here, and China's been pushing its own auto industry and companies quite a bit as well. So, you know, U.S. is not going to sell a lot more autos there. Auto companies will move there and set up 51% or more ownership. You see that already occurring with Tesla, right? And GM has plans as well, right? And finally, there's a commitment to buy $27 billion in U.S. Natural gas and oil. Right? U.S. has a massive glut of natural gas now, trying to push it around the world. It's building all these liquid national natural gas ports here, you know, in the Gulf area of the U.S., pushing and pressuring Europe to switch from Russian natural gas to U.S. natural gas because it's got this huge glut. If it doesn't get rid of this export, this natural gas, it'll have such an oversupply in the U.S. that it will cause prices to fall, and they don't want that. You know, they don't want to give us a deal on gasoline and natural gas here in the U.S. Keep the supply short by shipping this stuff offshore. So a lot of it will now go to China, right? But only according to China's market needs. Market needs, once again. This could well fall well short of the $27 billion purchases that's in the agreement here as well. Okay. You know, manufacturing and services, that's the facts. Behind the hype here. The next-gen tech war, next-generation technology war. Well, I've talked about that, you know, 5G, wireless, AI, cybersecurity. Both countries are rushing to expand that. And, you know, that's behind what the U.S. is trying to do to stop Huawei, Chinese company, telecom company, kind of like AT&T in China, from selling its 5G technology to phone companies around the world. You know, Huawei is the leading developer of that, along with Ericsson from Scandinavia, right? A big in Europe. Where's the U.S. in terms of 5G? Where's AT&T that used to be a tech leader in this? Nowhere. AT&T is busy developing entertainment content. That's where it's doing all its investing because the shadow bankers, the equity firms and hedge funds that are funding AT&T now, controlling it, are demanding quicker profits in that area. I mean, forget about next-gen technology. You know, for the private equity firms, they want returns quick, right? So AT&T is no longer the technology development giant it once was. You know, it's a content, software, entertainment content company. The U.S. is behind. That's why it's trying to slow down Huawei and 5G in Europe and elsewhere. Now, instead of developing our own, you know, it's let's stop other people from other countries from leapfrogging us, right? Spending all their political efforts and capital doing that. Using sanctions, by the way. Sanctions have become a typical tool, along with tariffs, of Trump trying to prevent other countries from developing. You know, the next-gen tech war, as I said, tech was decoupled from trade in phase one, and now it's a separate track. It will be have greater weight in any phase two negotiations, but nothing's going to happen there. What about subsidizing state-owned enterprises? You know, the U.S. has been complaining that China subsidizes its state-owned companies and other companies, you know, which makes a lower cost of doing business for China companies and makes them more competitive, lower cost, lower price, more competitive against the U.S. And other non-China companies. Subsidizing, in other words, stop subsidizing was the demand your these private companies. Let market forces determine competition. You know, stop subsidizing them, China government, right? Well, you know, that's such a farce. Because the U.S. engages in massive subsidization of its companies worldwide, right? How does it do that? Well, one way, massive tax cuts. You know, New York Times admitted, as I've been saying for the last 2 years, that Trump's 2018 tax cuts amounted to $5.5 trillion in tax cuts for corporations, businesses, and investors. $5.5 trillion. Yeah. Offset by raising taxes on the middle class and phony assumptions about economic growth and ignoring the true scope and magnitude of the tax cuts for U.S. multinational companies offshore. Well, we're going to summarize that article or that argument, in a forthcoming article here, although I've been writing and talking about it for 2 years here. Right? But the fact that finally New York Times has admitted it, you know, on December 31st at the end of the year, quietly, you know, while it's been peddling up to then, the idea it's only $1.5 trillion. Now it's $5.5 trillion for the rich investors, corporations, their businesses. Yeah. Well, that's how the U.S. subsidizes, the government subsidizes its businesses worldwide. And then, of course, it's got other subsidization tools like the Export-Import Bank and others. So, you know, U.S. engages in massive subsidization different than China. You see, if you've got a government-owned company in China, does it make any sense to lower taxes? These government companies don't pay taxes in the way we do here in the U.S. You know, it doesn't make sense to lower taxes on yourself, right? Just moving the money around. So, they subsidize in China in different ways. Particularly for government-owned enterprises over there, right? Or state-owned enterprises, as they call them, SOEs, right? State-owned enterprises. So, this whole thing about subsidization, China throws it back and says, you know, well, look, you know, you lower taxes, you have export-import subsidization, you know, you get free research and development financed by U.S. taxpayer, developed by DARPA, NSA, National Institutes of Health there for pharmaceuticals, right, and other means. So to say that we subsidize, you subsidize, too, everybody subsidizes. Their own government, capitalist government, subsidize their businesses in this competition, global competition for a bigger share of the global trade pie. Okay, so subsidizing state-owned enterprises, that did not get addressed in this phase one deal, nor did the cyber theft, nor did next-gen tech transfer. And that will be the topics of the next phase two. But there won't be anything come of it in an election year. Okay, so what's the total cost here of the trade bill? You know, what's the total cost of the China-U.S. trade war? Right? If you're going to assess the trade deal, this phase one deal, you got to consider not only what has been gained or not gained, falsified, but what has been the cost of 22 months of trade war to the U.S. economy, right? Has the trade war actually reduced the U.S. trade deficit with China or even with the rest of the world? Not really. Right? The deficit, for example, the trade deficit and goods deficit, which is mostly a deficit with China, was just under $350 billion when Trump assumed office in January 2017. This is according to the U.S. Census Bureau, by the way, this data. Right? That trade deficit in goods surged to $410 billion about by the end of 2018. In other words, the first 2 years, 1 year of the trade war, right? The trade deficit with China went from $350 billion to $410 billion, about $60 billion more increased under Trump. While we had this trade war occurring, the deficit was getting worse. Okay, it came down in 2019 back to about $350 billion. So Trump has reduced a trade deficit that he allowed to occur on his watch. Yeah, he set up a straw man. Oh, it's growing too high. Well, it was growing too high under your watch, right? And now he brings it down and says he achieved this great reduction in the U.S. trade deficit with China, we're talking about now, right? Oh, well, now with the Phase One trade deal, if China buys, $100 billion more, well, then, you're going to find that trade deficit with China go back up to $400 billion. You know, all this talk about reducing trade deficit is just smoke and mirrors. Yeah, he hasn't reduced anything. And now it's going to go the other way again, right? So the trade deficit with China, is where it was 2 years ago, 3 years ago, right? And it's going up. All right. Now, on a global scale, right, as we said, the China deficit ballooned and then leveled off to pre-Trump levels here, right? But the trade deficit with the rest of the world, U.S.'s trade deficit with the ROW, the rest of the world, has accelerated rapidly under Trump and has continued to do so. From roughly $375 billion when Trump entered office in January 2017, the trade deficit with the rest of the world has surged beyond $500 billion here as of last month. $500 billion. So much for these other trade wars apart from China, right? It's gotten much worse under Trump. Okay? It's risen, over $100 billion under Trump, from $375 to $500 billion. China's deficit went from $350 to $410, back down to $350. Well, there's been no back down here with deficit of the rest of the world going through the roof. Yeah. Still, so much for having achieved the goal of reducing the trade deficit that Trump said was one of the main objectives of his trade wars. And it was total failure in that regard. Right. Another area of the effect of these trade wars, Trump's wars, is that the tariffs on China, which is $370 billion still, right, have been passed on to U.S. companies. In every industry, fully passed on, except steel, where only half of the cost of tariffs have been passed on. Right? It cost U.S. businesses $42 billion. They passed most of that on to consumers and households, by the way. Now, a study by the Federal Reserve Bank of New York by authors Weinstein and Redding, quote, found that approximately 100% of import taxes fell on American buyers, end of quote. That's the New York Times, January 7th, page B4, if you want to look it up. Yeah. In other words, 100%. Cost $42 billion, 100% passed on to American buyers. Farmers took a big hit. Yeah. Now, Trump provided them $28 billion in direct subsidies, new direct subsidies, while this was going on, the cost of which is added to the U.S. budget deficit, which has now just been announced officially over $1 trillion, and the national debt, which is now over $23 trillion. Okay, so $28 billion is small, but it's been pretty much added to the budget and the deficit, right? And most of that $28 billion direct subsidy farm sector has gone to the larger farms, agribusiness, the smaller farms, 12,000 of them, latest number have foreclosed here, gone bankrupt, mostly smaller farmers. So the smaller farmers haven't gotten any of this largesse. It's gone mostly to big farms, agribusiness, $28 billion, $28 billion. Talk about subsidies, right? Farm income contracted in the last 2 years. It's been contracting. Farm loan delinquency rates have now risen to a six-year high, according to the FDIC, Federal Deposit Insurance Corporation, government agency. Right? And Chapter 12 farm bankruptcy filings are highest since 2012. So the farm sector, particularly small, medium farmers that have taken a big hit here, have not been bailed out to any significant extent. And we'll see, you know, how that affects the election results here in the coming election, because the farm sector has taken a big hit. And it doesn't look like that hit is going to be offset very much, very quickly here. As I said, $40 billion farm increases, farm purchases by China this year. Not likely. Okay. The trade war has also devastated U.S. business confidence. Mm-hmm. Business investment in the U.S. has contracted throughout 2019. We'll see if it continues to contract here. But that has been a big factor, you know, in U.S. economic growth softening, and will have its effects not just last year. Those effects will carry forward, because without business investment, you don't have real employment gains. You don't have wage increases being passed on. It's a very important part of the U.S. economy, and it's largely the trade war has done that to business confidence, right? A lot of that's been passed on to the consumer in higher prices for these tariffed goods, as we said. U.S. Households experienced a reduction of $806 in 2019 in real income spending due to the tariffs. Now, in other words, if you're paying more for goods, right, the amount more you're paying for inflation, you know, being passed on, tariffs passed on in prices, if you're paying more for something you're already buying, then you have less money, real money, to spend on increasing purchases in some other area. You know, you're just paying it up in inflation. It's eating up, you know, $806 in real income spending levied on average. It's an average number, you know, so some more than $800, some less. Okay. So, you know, to summarize here, you know, what the economic effects are, cost business $42 billion, passed it all on virtually to consumers and households, $806 on average reduction. Federal Bank saying that 100%, Federal Reserve Bank, import taxes fell on American buyers, U.S. farmers taking a big hit, particularly small, medium farmers, income declining, loan delinquency rates at six-year high, farm bankruptcies, eight-year high, right? Business confidence whacked, right? And also estimate here, I forget exactly the source, but worldwide, globally, the trade wars have had effective like $700 billion reduction in the global GDP. Okay. Concluding remarks here, the Trump administration spokespersons Larry Kudlow, Trump's economic advisor, Steve Mnuchin, Treasury Secretary, according to the latest reports, are peddling the prediction that the U.S. economy will grow by up to 0.75% more in GDP terms this year as a result of phase one. Yeah, sure. Well, that's assumed. You know, a 0.5% growth is the assumption of $100 billion more in purchases and U.S. exports to China. $100 billion more. That's how you get the 0.5%. I don't know how you get the 0.75% unless there's a multiplier effect being factored in here. But that's not going to happen. You're not going to see $100 billion more, as I've said, for all those reasons here previously. Okay, so you know, it's been a big farce. It's been a big farce here. A lot of smoke and mirrors in this phase one deal, and we're not going to see much in reality here. It's a mini deal, all right. Mini meaning not just small, but minimal. Okay, that's my analysis. Okay, I wanted to get into talking about the top 10 tech events here of 2019. you know, added to our top 10 economic political events we've already talked about, listened to previous immediate shows. I don't think we have that much time to really get into it in the rest of the show, but just if I can list them very quickly, big event 2019 in tech, of course, was the development and rollout of the element of artificial intelligence called generative adversarial neural networks, what's called deep fakes, right, affecting voice and facial replication. That's coming. Hypersonic missiles, Russia, hypersonic torpedoes, smart torpedoes, right? Surveillance tech, you know, Alexa and Google's and enterprise versions of this, right? And listening to us when we don't even have them turned on. Drone technology, military, consumer, right? And business drone technology. Facebook Libra, which failed, generating a alternative digital currency trading system like the SWIFT system. That was a major development last year. The Internet of Things taking off, right? Over 20 billion devices now involved in the Internet of Things. 5G implementation already beginning. The talk about, I don't know how far it's gone, establishing an alternative international payment system to SWIFT by the Europeans called instex. And then finally, genome sequencing cost, now well below $1,000, going to $100, right? This is CRISPR gene editing technology occurring in vivo, as they say, not in petri dishes. In other words, injecting it into human beings and having it change your genetic definition here to solve a health problem, right? What this means to big pharma and their pills, right, and vaccinations is going to be very interesting here. So last year, just to sum up, AI, neural networks here, deep fakes, hypersonic missiles, surveillance tech, drone tech, Facebook's Libra, Internet of Things, 5G implementation, instex, and genome sequencing cost decline. These are all important developments here in 2019 in technology. And those important developments are going to have an impact on the economy and politics in the coming decade here. Okay, so that's it for today on the show, and we will undoubtedly have some pressing topics to discuss, and I want to get on to discussing the big economic and political events of the last decade, not the last year, and we'll take that up next week. Okay, that's it. Next week, talk to you.